Our next speaker is Andrew Sandler. Andrew is co-chair of Buckley Sandler. He's a recognized leader in financial services enforcement litigation. He represents corporate clients, including banks, financial services companies, mortgage lenders, and more. Thank you, Andrew, for coming.
Thank you. I'm going to have to work hard to differentiate myself from the comments that were just made, many of which I agree with. First, my disclaimer. As a defense lawyer, I feel absolutely free to speak for the FTC, all the federal banking agencies, and other state and local enforcement and regulatory bodies. I would also like to propose a different name for this new agency, which may signal where I'm going to be going for the next 10 minutes or so. The Directorate for Fewer and More Expensive Loans. We don't need another agency. We have lots of agencies. We have the Federal Reserve Board, the Office of Thrift Supervision, the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency, the FDIC, the DOJ, 50 state AGs, state banking departments, state civil rights commissions, state consumer protection agencies, et cetera, et cetera. We don't need another agency. And indeed, as just mentioned, we have a federal agency with consumer protection responsibility. That's called the Federal Trade Commission. Hasn't done a very good job on these issues to date, but then neither has any of the other agencies. We don't need more laws and regulations. We've got HOPA, TILA, RESPA, Section 5, Fair Housing Act, Equal Credit Opportunity Act, on and on and on and on. We've got lots of laws, we've got lots of regulations. They were enough to address this problem. What we need is less. What we need is one clear set of rules that is consistently enforced, which is precisely what this new agency is designed not to give us, but rather to be one more voice and perhaps a rather radical voice on these issues. The problem is not lack of agencies, lack of laws. The problem we're confronting is a failure of enforcement. And to understand the failure of enforcement over the past 10 years, we've got to take a quick look back at what the root of the problem was. This problem that we're talking about began with the mortgage industry, with home ownership gone bad. And the problem goes back to a very, very worthy objective, the American dream of home ownership for all. What was the result of that? Politicians and community advocates, including some of the same community advocates that were on panels earlier today and who may even be in the administration now, took the view that increasing home ownership rates was critical to achieving the American dream for low and moderate income persons, and particularly for minorities, and that anything that could be done to achieve that objective was worthwhile. Bankers, who are not without blame in this, more loans equal more fees, equal more income, whether it's at the origination side, at the securitization side, or anywhere down the channel that we hear so much about. So bankers were all about more loans for more people, the American dream of home ownership. Consumers love the idea of being able to buy a house without a down payment and without any imposition on lifestyle. Those of us who are a little older recall buying our first houses by saving and scraping for years to get a 20% deposit and then paying a monthly payment which actually constituted principal, interest, taxes, and insurance. Remember escrow? So the way we extend it, the way we expand home ownership is, one, make credit available to credit-impaired borrowers, This is this was unambiguously initially a very good thing. Later it became not such a good thing in the way it was implemented. The other thing that we did was we took very many innovative steps to reduce monthly cost, because when you start talking about expanding home ownership, that means making homes affordable, that means lower monthly payment. That is all that most consumers care about, particularly when they, as well as their government, their regulators, their bankers, and everybody else seem to believe we've defeated the business cycle, and homes are always going to go up in value, and interest rates are never going to go up. So if that's everybody's mindset, then all of these innovative products designed to decrease monthly costs are a great thing. We initially made great progress in expanding home ownership. All good. At some point, the tipping point, right? We started making loans that made absolutely no sense. Bankers started making loans that made no sense. Borrowers started taking loans that made no sense. And regulators and enforcement agencies sat on the sidelines and applauded bankers and borrowers in doing things that made no sense, because we were all chasing the dream of home ownership, and we all believed that the business cycle had been defeated and that the price would never be paid. So what was the failure of enforcement as just presented? Safety and soundness. This wasn't a failure. I mean, there were many, many consumer protection failures here. But fundamentally, the regulatory failure was a safety and soundness failure. And it was a safety and soundness failure, first and foremost, by the lenders who were making loans that had no prospect of being repaid, by the borrowers who were taking loans that they had no chance of paying off, but most importantly, by the regulators who are supposed to harness the benefits of the market and competition and innovation by ensuring that the insurance fund is protected and that the banking system is protected. That did not occur. So I would concur that, not that there isn't a very significant consumer protection problem where the agencies out there with the expertise and the personnel and the laws and the regulations need to do a heck of a better job. By the way, including the AGs and the state enforcement agencies who had the principal responsibility with respect to the small lenders who led the rest of the industry like lemmings over the cliff. Who were their regulators? The state AGs, the state agencies, not the federal banking regulators, who didn't do a very good job either, but they weren't the one regulating the unregulated small mortgage lenders who initially started offering products that made no sense, drove monthly payments down, so that the only way banks could compete, and I'm not excusing it, but the only way banks could compete in that marketplace where they were told by the government, you will compete or else we will accuse you of discrimination, among other things, and of not meeting your CRA obligations, among other things. The only way banks could compete was by offering products that had the same low monthly costs. Those products made absolutely no sense for anybody. So that was the problem. We are in Congress's effort to address the last problem, never the future problem, always the last problem, which is what Congress does best, the blame game. It has not come up, nor has the administration come up, with an effective, forward-looking position. We need to make sure that safety and soundness regulation is done more effectively going forward. There are lots of lessons here. We need to make sure that the agencies with consumer protection enforcement responsibility do their job better. And on that front, I'm not sure that I disagree with the concept, and I know this is not the majority view, certainly among my client base and in the banking industry generally. I'm not sure that taking consumer protection and separating it from safety and soundness isn't a good idea, because they're different sets of issues. And maybe if the bank regulators were focused on safety and soundness instead of whether one group was paying 2 basis points more than another group on a statistically significant sample, which is the only thing the consumer people at all the banking agencies were paying any attention to for the last 10 years, maybe they would have done a better job on safety and soundness. So I think there are lots of lessons. I think we probably need fewer agencies and fewer rules rather than more, but because that will yield better, more effective enforcement and more and lower priced loan products for consumers. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is my colleague, Sam Issacharoff. Sam is the Reiss Professor of Constitutional Law at NYU School of Law. Sam is a leader in a wide range of areas, but most pertinent to our discussion today, he's been a leader in behavioral law and economics and in complex litigation. So thank you, Sam, for coming.
Thanks, Oren. A few months ago, I was at a gathering that included Robert Solow, the Nobel laureate economist. This topic of the gathering was the financial crisis. You'll find that this is not the first conference held on this topic. And Solow, in his characteristically insightful way, made a point that I think bears repeating, and that is that we should not confuse the finance sector of the economy for the real economy. And it does not necessarily follow that the regulatory strategies or deregulatory strategies that we would advocate or adopt for the real economy should necessarily be applied to the finance economy. Put more colloquially, it may well have been once upon a time that what was good for GM was good for America. I am rather skeptical of the proposition that what is good for Goldman Sachs is necessarily good for America. Or even more colloquially, Liz Warren at lunch talked about the relation between toasters and consumer credit, and it reminded me of a generation ago when to open a checking account, banks would induce you with a toaster. And I think that the time has come to sever the relationship between toasters, which are real and whose innovation we should applaud, and finance, which is problematic. It is not clear to me that every new generation of derivatives has been a boon for us. So one can have different regulatory approaches to different sectors of the economy. And if we start with the proposition that there may be financial sector innovations that we as a society do not want, it may caution us to apply the lessons of behavioral economics too easily and to eschew more traditional forms of command and control regulation. It is not clear to me that we do not have a role as a result of the experience of the last decade for some ex-ante rules that are fixed, hard, inflexible, over-regulatory, and nonetheless may be desirable. It may be that we should go back to minimum amounts necessary for mortgages. It may be that we should go back to minimum capitalization levels for banks. It may be that we should prohibit certain kinds of securitizations. It may be. It does not follow from our move toward deregulation, successful deregulation in the products markets, that we may want, that we do not want to have harder regulatory approaches in the areas of finance, particularly as they pertain to consumer relations. And so even though I have spent a fair amount of time over the past years on the issue of asymmetric paternalism, one of the articles I was involved with, or soft paternalism, I am not certain how much ultimately is going to be gained through the soft paternalistic methods of things like disclosures. There are certain gains to be had from the Schumer box, from putting things in plain English, from making certain points salient, but I believe that this is, that the best information we have from the behavioral literature is that this is always going to be limited. And it's going to be limited for two reasons. One is that finance is secondary to other activity. It is secondary to the acquisition of material goods, which should dwarf the question of finance in the minds of the consumers. So we know from studies 30 years ago that people are very attentive to housing prices, they're very attentive to household appliances when they go shopping for them, but they pay no attention to relative costs on title insurance or closing costs on their house. Why? Because they can't reckon with that in the context of buying a house which is going to cost 1,000 times more or 100 times more, whatever it is, than the closing transaction costs involved. And besides, you get to roll it into the mortgage anyway, so it's like it disappears and it doesn't bother you at all. And in some sense, that's always, I think, going to be the nature of the house purchase, and that's why we have to be worried about things that are non-salient to consumers. Secondarily, I think that one of the great things that has happened in this country since World War II has been the democratization of credit. Credit is now available to all sectors of the society, sometimes too much so. That's the subject of debate, as the last two speakers indicated. But the fact that it is now democratized means that there's going to be necessary asymmetries between an industry which is always relatively concentrated, which has relatively high barriers to entry, which is never going to be as fully competitive as some of the smaller item consumer areas of the market, and the consumers who are oftentimes one-shot players who have limited capacity to integrate information. And in that kind of asymmetric market, you are always going to have the risk of exploitative behavior. And so there are some things that the market actually checks, and it checks beyond that which the initial behavioral law and economics literature would have admitted. Because it turns out the consumers learn. And that as they learn, the product offerers have to come forward with differentiation, market differentiation, that is meaningful to the consumers. So on credit cards, consumers figured out very quickly that annual fees of $30 is more than an annual fee of zero. Even Stefan's idiots this morning can do that math. Type one or whatever you call them at Columbia. And they also, it turns out, over time, learned how to differentiate interest rates. So that became salient, and that became a subject of market competition in a way that some of the early literature would not have anticipated. On the other hand, fees on the use of credit cards abroad, late fees, charges for payments received after 1 p.m., holidays counted against cardholders, nobody in their right mind would ever have picked up on any of these, even if they were the subject of full, complete, frank disclosure. So the question is, what's the regulatory approach that follows if you have democratized markets, if you want credit in the hands of folks like this, if you're worried about agencies, and particularly agency capture, and all the kinds of regulatory issues that came today? And I would suggest that there is a role in this world for something that I'll call regulatory pluralism. And regulatory pluralism assumes that there will be the risk of capture. It assumes that ex-ante regulation will always over and under regulate. It assumes that there will be room for innovation. There must be room for innovation. And with the innovation comes the capacity for exploitative behavior. So what do you do in these circumstances? Well, I would suggest that one of the things that we have to look at is ex post accountability. That is, you have to be able to sue the bastards. And that's the American way of life. And it's worked well in this country, but not in this area. And let me give you two examples of what prevents ex post accountability, which I think is a serious issue, particularly on the credit card side. The mortgage stuff I haven't looked at, but I've written a little bit on credit cards. First, National Bank Act. National Bank Act was a problem in the United States. The states were going after the National Bank, McCulloch v. Maryland, all these kind of the classic issues. Well, so we created the National Bank Act, which says states keep your hands off the national banks. Then we did the most amazing regulatory thing, worse even, Rachel, than getting your money from the people you regulate and then begging them to be your customer. We said we would have National Bank Act with the power of preemption, but the only regulator would be the bank, would be the state in which you are chartered, right? Now that's brilliant, brilliant, because that means that the states can be played off against each other. It means they have the revenues from offering the business, but they can export the costs onto the consumers in all the other states. And the Supreme Court in 1978, in a case called Marquette versus First Omaha, said that's absolutely the way it is. No other state can try to mess with usury rates because the rates are set by the state in which you're chartered. And in 1996, in Smiley v. Citibank, the Supreme Court comes along and says, and everything else that has to go with charges and fees and all that, that's all done in one state. If you look in your wallet and you pull out your credit cards, you will see what state you have to call in case of a problem. And overwhelmingly, it's South Dakota. Number two, it's Delaware. There are six states which together account for 4% of the population of the United States, which last time I looked, controlled through their laws 70% of the credit card debt in the United States. And that's not an accident. That's a terrible system because what it means is it disables the states and their parens patriae and regulatory powers to go after improper activity directed at their citizens. It removes a source of accountability. The second is a question that is a burning issue right now in the courts. It's been in the Supreme Court in a couple of guises, and that is a protection against ex post accountability, not to the public authorities, but to the private authorities. And this is the prohibition on class actions, the requirement that you must go to arbitration on an individual basis for any dispute with the credit card company, let alone the fact that there's one or two outfits that actually do these arbitrations, the rare occasion where they're invoked, and the credit card companies win 100% of the time. Leave that issue aside. The idea that it's going to be up to the consumer to fight over $2, $10, $20, $100, we know that's never going to happen. So we have, between the National Bank Act interpretation and the anti-collective action prohibitions, what we have is an insulation of activity from any kind of ex post accountability. And so the question is, however we set up a new regulatory environment, and I'll close with a statement on that, there has to be a recognition that this is a market in which innovation is going to be problematic because of information asymmetries, because of the congenital inability of humans to process all this kind of information. Our lives are busy. I have other things to do than read credit card disclosures if they come in the mail every month. Maybe you don't. I do. And this is not the way we want Americans to lead their lives, right? You know, and then you can go to the cable company disclosures and all the others, and you'll have a very full life. So we need to have mechanisms that expose these kinds of large actors in democratized markets to ex post mechanisms of accountability in front of agents who have the incentive to hold their feet to the fire. Now, this raises problems. It's going to play out in a number of ways. It plays out in the preemption debate, where for years you had major manufacturers resisting any kind of regulation, and then they decided that they liked regulation by friendly regulators better than the common law, right? This is a point von Hayek made, this point about the strength of the common law, that it has multiple sources of authority so it cannot be corrupted and captured in the same way. There has to be a balance, there has to be a regulatory compliance defense which has not yet been well developed in the law. There has to be a safe harbor where there is affirmative regulation. On the other hand, there has to be accountability. And let me just close with what I would hold out as a parable, except that it's true. And that is, I began my teaching career at Texas, which is a great, powerful state that veers between a love of big concentration of wealth and a populist hatred of it. And during one of its populist periods, they decided in Texas that the insurance companies, pronounced properly insurance companies, were too powerful. So they created a commissioner of insurance. Great. That was a big, powerful act. And of course, in a few years, they were dismayed because the insurance commissioner was completely captured by the industry. So Texas decided, how do we get around the regulatory capture issue? This is really hard. They had an idea. They created the Office of Public Counsel of the insurance commissioner, whose job it was to lobby and litigate on behalf of the public as against the insurance commissioner in its regulation of insurance, because the assumption was the insurance commissioner was going to be regulated, was going to be captured. Okay, you'll never guess what happened next. So you got to love regulators, regulate the regulators and all that, but come to court sometimes.
Thank you, Sam. Our next speaker is Raj Date. Raj is chairman and executive director of Cambridge Winter, a nonprofit that focuses on financial institution regulation. In his previous life, Raj was a managing director in the financial institutions group at Deutsche Bank Securities. And even earlier than that, he was senior vice president at Capital One Financial. Thank you, Raj, for coming.
Thank you. And while this thing loads up here, Oren just mentioned, I spent most of the last 12 or so years in the business, in consumer finance and in commercial banking and investment banking, and the experience has left me hardened a little bit. And so I hope you won't view this as ungracious, because I'm going to start my comments with a little bit of constructive feedback. If you are in this room, the chances are that you are de facto part of the intellectual elite of U.S. consumer finance, whether you like it or not. And as being part of the intellectual elite of U.S. consumer finance, you have really fouled this thing up. We are working off a $6 trillion hangover in the U.S. resi market. It is going to take a long time to work through. Usually in the field of human events, if you foul something up that bad, you're unemployed and you slowly starve to death. The American people have seen fit to give us another chance. So I guess my feedback is, let's try not to mess this up again. That said, let me start by talking about why it is that I think in notable contrast to some others today, I think this is the central issue. The regulation of consumer finance in the U.S. is the central issue to making financial regulatory reform work. And if I can cause this to happen, okay. So what is the consumer finance market? At its core, it is just sort of the aggregation of lots of different private party transactions. You know, they're independent, atomized transactions between, on the one hand, bank management teams and customers on the other. So, you know, there's kind of an obvious problem at the outset. It's that both parties to the transaction have a positive risk bias. If you are a bank manager, you tend to have an asymmetric outcome. Risks turn out well, you get paid. Risks don't turn out well, there is no obvious negative consequence that's quite as bad. And similarly, consumers, this is a mostly non-recourse world in which we live. Consumers have a pro-risk bias as well. But not to fear, because if risk-taking gets out of control, of course, bank boards of directors, the trusty stewards of the equity markets and shareholders, are meant to discipline bank management teams. I think it has been pointed out there are some problematic aspects with respect to board of directors' capabilities, which is one of my bugaboos, as well as incentives. But don't worry. I mean, banks and finance companies are amazingly levered, and so the debt market should discipline bank boards of directors and keep them from getting out of control through their trusty proxies, the rating agencies. And if somehow that doesn't work out, you know, of course, then we have the regulators, you know, both systemic and prudential regulators. So if somehow bank management teams, bank boards of directors, and rating agencies all conspire to, you know, layer on risk onto the system, you know, the regulators stand ready to nip it in the bud. So what could possibly go wrong? Well, as it turns out, almost everything. Let me suggest something. I get asked often when people, and I talk about this framework a lot, like they ask, what's wrong with boards of directors and rating agencies and regulators? Are they all incompetent or are they all corrupt? And the answer actually, yeah there is a little bit about, but the answer is neither. Neither. The problem is they're human beings. And it is impossible to set up any of these institutions to somehow hold back the power of bad ideas that emanates from the core credit market and consumer finance. Can't be done. Now, why is that? Consumer finance is uniquely, I would argue, susceptible to the scalability of bad ideas. Really, really dreadful ideas. Most markets, if you come up with a better toaster or you build a better mousetrap, the world, in fact, beats a path to your door. That's not true here. And the reason for that is that bad products systematically crowd out good ones. I spent 5 years of my life trying to figure out how to participate in the U.S. mortgage market. You couldn't do it if some clown at GMAC was offering a 125 loan-to-value loan. It cannot be done. And by the way, I know it's fashionable in some circles to say there's no such thing as a bad product. You know, you're just transplanting your own Ivy League sensibilities upon the common man. I could use my elitist sensibilities, but I'm not going to. I'm going to use just common sense. A bad product is something that's bad for consumers. It's not something you would put your brother into. If my brother called me in 2006 and said, hey, I'm going to get an option arm, I would say yes, because you're an idiot. That is a bad idea. And so, you know, don't confuse yourself. This is not a University of Chicago, you know, undergrad seminar. This is real life. These things matter. Common sense sometimes works. They're also bad for investors, right? There's no reason why anyone would ever be buying an asset-backed security that's based on option arm collateral in 2006. It means you're either an idiot or you're probably more likely playing with someone else's money. That's the only reason any of that ever got funded. So what causes this to happen? Three things. Number one, that I suspect that there is an ethics problem in consumer finance. I just mentioned it because I don't know what the solution is. I don't think you can legislate a solution. I do think there are leaders in this room who have the ear of top management teams across this country. And you are lawyers, and to the extent that you have not been influencing people to do the right thing on the margin, shame on you, right? But it's not going to come out of Congress. So put that one aside. The things we can do something about are broken value transparency, so one kind of information asymmetry, and broken funding market feedback, another kind of information asymmetry. How do we fix these things to try to get better market-based outcomes? Part of the problem here, let's just talk about it in terms of the business system, the way that most people, like regular people, think about finance is like this. You know, you've got two parties. You've got a customer and you've got a bank, and the bank does all the bank-like stuff. The reality, unfortunately, is rather different. Obviously, the business system over time, really over the course of my career, has been splintered among lots of different participants in a way that should be more, you know, efficient. If you like playing with other people's money, you should be a CDO manager. If you like paperwork, you should be a loan servicer. You know, if you're kind of sleazy, you should get at the mortgage broker business. There's lots of different ways to play. But structure matters. Industry structure matters, and it matters in predictable ways, in ways that we should have known ahead of time. One way, and I'm not going to talk about this one, is that having intermediaries between a customer and a lender accentuates, it emphasizes bad stuff that happens with respect to the natural asymmetry between a lender and a borrower. There are good examples of that at lunchtime. I think the FTC has done, frankly, some of the only fact-based kind of empirical work on this issue. It is a disaster because it's so easy to get a consumer to believe they're paying less than they actually are. So if you're an ethical kind of person who wants to do the right thing and compete in a profitable market, you can't get customers to take your product because they think that they're paying less with the scam product they're already in. This is a real problem. And this is the fundamental reason why that which goes under the guise of consumer protection, but I think is a much broader concept, is so important. Second asymmetry is just as pernicious, frankly, is as you kind of parcel up risk and hand it from participant to participant, gets further and further attenuated from the actual borrower, naturally people start making bad decisions about risk and pricing it wrong. What happens is, you know, you get this dual aspect of dubious loans get funded, and by the way, the business models that involve originating garbage and selling it on are actually less capital intensive than originating good stuff and holding it. So once again, bad products crowd out good products, and you can't get past go to improve things. This is a disaster. There are risk retention requirements that have been there in the House bill, and various components of various forms of it have been talked about. I usually do not like ideas that I did not think of. I actually do think this is a good idea. It's going to be hard. Like most of these are hard problems, so this will be hard to do because you have twin objectives. On the one hand, you do want to reinstill some discipline from credit performance to pricing. You got to build that feedback loop again. But at the same time, you don't want to destroy liquidity through the capital structure. Like, I think we would all be better off if Merrill Lynch, right, had been selling more credit into the marketplace instead of holding it. So how do you do that? I would suggest, and there's a lot of work to do, I would suggest you focus on two variables. Variable number one, what is the seller's influence on the value of the loan? So a mortgage broker, there's a reason why a mortgage broker-originated product performs so poorly compared to retail, because they have a lot of influence on who that borrower is. They stick them into things that don't make sense. The game you with a lender, it's a disaster. Same thing with auto dealers. If you have a lot of influence over the value of the loan, chances are you should retain more risk. Second, if it's easy for the markets to diligence the loans that you're selling into it, kind of re-underwrite it in effect, well then, if it's easy for them to re-underwrite, I should hold less risk. So those are the two variables, if it were me, I think I would focus on. And it's fun to play games. You can say, well, then where do various products lie? Here's an area where the market's got it right, credit card receivables. The credit card servicer has a ton of influence on the value of the receivable, a ton. It is basically impossible as a bondholder to re-underwrite these things. But the asset-backed markets never let you do an asset-backed deal in credit card without a big old seller's interest, that is to say, the risk retained by the credit card originator. And there's a reason why, therefore, credit card ABS deals aren't blowing up all over the country the way mortgage deals are. It's because this risk retention worked. It hasn't really worked in auto loans. I would argue that auto loans are kind of a medium category. We should see more risk retention than the markets have asked for. And there are plenty of categories where really zero or very low risk retention is probably appropriate. So whole loan sales of commercial real estate, I'd argue, by banks, I would probably put in that area. Listen, none of these are easy questions, but I think the outlines of a good and holistic response are being debated. I think people mean well, but I am serious. By and large, actual people in the world don't particularly care who was right and wrong about GSE reform 10 years ago. To the extent there's not a productive dialogue that is being led in part by people in this room, you know, we should all feel pretty bad about ourselves. So with that ringing kind of, you know, go get them speech.
Thank you, Raj. Our final panelist is Frank Borchert. Frank is general counsel of Chase Card Services, and previously he served in the administration of George W. Bush as senior advisor and counselor to the Secretary of the Department of Housing and Urban Development. And Frank, you some responses to what we've heard?
Yeah, I guess I'd have a lot to cover, but we can't be here for another day. Maybe I should make first my own disclaimers. I actually was hoping that we could engage more in a Q&A because I'm interested in what you all as consumers of all of this information really are thinking and wondering about, but we've run out of time. So I will make just a couple of remarks. And the second disclaimer is that I'm not gonna claim to speak for all lenders. Obviously there are lots of lenders, great and small. I don't even necessarily speak for the very largest lenders. And I think it's also, probably worth noting, I don't necessarily speak for whatever happened in the federal government while I was working there. So, first, maybe just a couple of comments about what we think at Chase right now. And it's something I think we've thought for a long time, but I wasn't there, so I can't claim to talk about that. And that is that when consumers succeed, we succeed. There's no question, you know, and I could walk through a couple of the different products, but, and I feel like I'm lowering the tone a little bit because I work for a company, and so I'm not going to use lots of high words. I'm not big on asymmetries and the rest of it. But what I am focused on is the fact that basically if in the credit card space, if one customer charges off, then it takes 10, 12, 13 profitable customers or more to make up for that. So we really, there actually is a significant incentive at heart for us to help our customers succeed. In addition, when you think about it, and just to add on to that, right now credit card charge-off rates are, you know, roughly around 10%. Very high, roughly in line with the unemployment rate. That's not unusual, that's not even unexpected. And as a result of that, most of the large card companies are losing significant amounts of money, including Chase. We certainly hope that won't continue, but it is going on. If I turn to the mortgage space, the mortgage product, it's even more significant. Again, one charge-off is incredibly damaging. It takes numerous profitable customers to make up for that. So again, the incentives are for us to help our customers succeed. Do we all need to do a better job offering better products for customers? Absolutely. Do we need customers to be more financially literate? I think there's no question about that. At times, it feels like there's such a cacophony now of information about financial literacy that it's hard to keep up with. But that's critical. So again, when our customers succeed, you know, we succeed. I might suggest to all of you, if you haven't noticed it, we recently launched a new product. It took 2 years of development. We spent a lot of time with customer focus groups. It's called Blueprint. It's attached to some of our card products. And the purpose of it is to put consumers more in control of how they charge and how they pay back. And we spent, again, a lot of time with customer focus groups asking them what they wanted. And what consumers basically told us was, we want to be in charge. We don't want you telling us what to do. And we want more control over our own finances. And so Blueprint is an attempt to get at that. I think you're going to see, given the nature of the Card Act and all the restrictions, you're probably going to see a lot of attempts at product innovation. Some of those attempts will work. Some of them won't work. I think it's going to be actually a very interesting time because of the nature of the Card Act itself. It's forcing, it's going to force all financial institutions to innovate. But again, take a look at Blueprint and see what you think. Just one of the features of that particular product is called Full Pay. So I think many of you may know when you carry a balance on your card, you pay interest on all new charges as well. At least I hope you all know that. I'm referencing back to Raj's thing that you all are part of the financial elite here. So you carry a balance, you pay interest on new charges. Well, Blueprint is designed to allow you to specify categories where, as long as you pay those categories in full, like for example groceries, you won't be charged interest on charges, even though you may be carrying a balance on that card account. Okay, so there's, again, this is an attempt to give customers more control over what they do. A second comment I might make, I think, and that has to do with the regulatory system as it exists currently. Again, I'm probably saying something everyone understands here, but there is a massive amount of regulation that goes on right now. Every day, you know, at our bank, we have numerous regulators in on both the consumer side, consumer protection side, and also on the safety and soundness side. So there are numerous rules and regulations. You know, each new law that gets passed, I get to make another pitch for more lawyers and compliance people to work with those. So some of the comments that have been made previously, I think I would very much associate myself with, which is that we support regulatory reform. We support smart reform. That may mean, and I think the president has said this, that may mean that some regulations need to go, and some new regulations are needed. But don't kid yourself that there's not a lot of regulation out there already, because there is. We've also, in frequent comment letters on new regulations, including Reg Z under TILA, we've suggested that we very much support, for example, what the Federal Reserve might be doing. But we've also advocated, and this is something I think, that Janice spoke about earlier, we've very much supported, and I think this is critical, that the regulators themselves get much smarter and do a lot more consumer testing. When we do consumer testing on products, we've also done, and I've personally done some of this recently, we've done our own testing on disclosures to see what will consumers understand, again, to make them more successful. I don't think nearly enough goes on. When I was at HUD, it was put to me as a significant improvement that in the case of the RESPA rule, that the research division had actually done consumer testing. The good faith estimate, I think, is, as discussed, is obviously you know, a critical piece of information, and yet this was the first time really some real consumer testing had been done, at least at HUD. So I think as we go forward at regulating consumer products, I think we all will benefit from a lot more consumer testing by regulators. And then finally, I guess I would say, just on the intersection of safety and soundness in consumer protection, obviously there are, you know, you've heard many different viewpoints on this. I would suggest that one thing, you know, is worth keeping in mind is that a lot of institutions now don't exist because, which is a safety and soundness issue, because of consumer protection issues that they had. So there is a real benefit, and it's obviously, I think, a critical point, to keep safety and soundness together. The framework for which that's done, obviously, you know, there are ways in which it could differ. But Congress obviously sees that. I think even in the House bill, at least for some portion of the financial services industry, there is a greater retention of safety and soundness and consumer protection regulation. So size matters, apparently, in that field. I'm not sure that it does. I think that's something that's worthy of additional consideration. So anyways, I think that's it for me.
Thank you very much, Frank. So I've prepared some concluding remarks, but I'm going to just throw them out the window because we're over time. So let me just thank our panelists and speakers again. These are really hard questions. I wanted to stand here at the end of the day and say that we've answered them. Of course, we have not. But we've heard a lot of different perspectives and opinions, not all of them consistent with one another. But I hope we came out with a little bit better understanding of what CFPs are and how they should be regulated. So again, thank you to our speakers. Thank you to our co-sponsors, the NYU School of Law and the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. And I want to extend a special thanks to Mike Campbell for bearing most of the burden of this conference. Thank you, Michael. Thank you all for coming.
A lot of fun. Enjoyed it. Enjoyed your remarks.